Dale and I wanted to just kind of spend some time tonight sharing our hearts with you all. We're going to be sharing a little bit about being church planters' wives. We're going to be sharing a little bit about what is a church plant. How many of you know that CrossPointe is a church plant? Not everybody? How many didn't know CrossPointe was a church plant? Anybody? One. There's one person. Well, CrossPointe is a church plant. But Gail and I wanted to just kind of have a conversation and share our hearts. And because I know that so many times we hear those words, church plant, especially today. Today it is heard more. But I think maybe not everybody really knows what that is or why that is or what's behind it or any of that. But Gail and her husband have been in the church planting world a whole lot longer than I have been. And so I just kind of wanted to start off with Gail and she and David and kind of walk through their journey a little bit. And we'll kind of mingle our journeys together. We actually met for the very first time last May, and we have become fast friends. This is the fifth time I've seen her, or fourth, you, since May, but I'm excited about that, and we plan to see them many more times. But Gail and David, that's her husband, they are Sin City missionaries in Boston, and we're going to talk about that a little bit more. But they've been in the church planting world for quite some time. So Gail, tell us, if you don't mind, kind of share with us, like, when did y'all enter this world of church planting? How did this all begin for you?
Well, church planting, when we went into it, was really not well known. It's church planting today, you can find books and books and books on church planting. You can find all kinds of church plants all over the country. But in 1987, when we first heard about church planting, there wasn't much about church planting. David heard a message on the radio about two church planters who had planted churches, one in Chicago and one in California, and that was Bill Hybels and Rick Warren, who most of you, I'm sure, have heard about. But they were talking about starting a church that was different. So we kind of started thinking in that direction. And then about that same time, we visited a friend who was at Harvard in a ministry position with Crew, and he took us around the city, showed us the sights, and Boston began to just grab our heart. So from that moment on, it's been about 30 years ago or more, Boston was just in our hearts. So we kind of took the church planting idea, we took the love for Boston, and thought we would put them together. So we began to think about going to Boston and planting a church, not really knowing much about church planting. But as we got further and further into the process, God said, not yet. This is not the time. So we put that on hold until several years later, when someone in Louisville contacted us about being a church planter in Louisville. And I'm sure church planting in Louisville, when you think about that, you think, why in the world would you want to start a church in Louisville? I'm sure they have plenty. And I'm sure Linnell and David thought the same thing. People thought the same thing. Why would you plant a church in Valdosta? Are there not plenty of churches? Mm-hmm. But we wanted to do church differently. And so we accepted that call to plant a church in Louisville. Mm.
That's a key word, is different, because when you plant a church, that is one of the main reasons you plant a church, is because there's a need for something different. It's not a different message. It's the same Jesus. But you step back and you realize there are people that don't go to church. Why? You start to ask yourself, God starts to put on your heart, why? And he starts to cause our husbands and us to begin to process that. And when y'all had that call and you knew it was time to plant a church, How did you know who to, what did you go at? Who did you bring to your church? Who came to your church? How did you know who to ask to come to your church?
Right, that's a very good question, because when you are a church planter, you don't have a built-in group of people who are waiting for you. Our first church was in Knoxville, Tennessee, and when we moved there, there were people waiting to help us unload the truck. There was food in the refrigerator. People brought meals over. People came over to help us unpack. But when we moved to Louisville, there were no people. There was my sweet daddy, who was really too old to be helping us move. David's brother and David were our welcoming committee to Louisville. And they helped us move into our house. And there was no food in the refrigerator, and nobody brought meals. So we were nobody special, you know. So it was a very new experience. So we had to find people. And where we wanted to plant this church was in a specific area in Louisville, in East Louisville. And the reason we wanted to plant there is because it was a growing area of town. And again, we wanted to reach people who weren't going to church. And I think that's the question, or that's the kind of the answer to, well, why do you want to plant another church? Mm-hmm. Well, if you've got a lot of churches, but you still have a lot of people who aren't going to church, then you obviously need to do something different. And so that's what we wanted to do. We didn't want to do the same thing everyone else was doing, because we wanted to reach those people out there who weren't going to those churches that were doing pretty much all the same thing. We wanted to reach people who weren't going to church for one reason or the other. Either they didn't know to go to church, they didn't know anything about God, or maybe they knew about God and just didn't really care, or maybe they had been to church as a younger kid and they just quit going. So those were the people we wanted to come to our church, mm-hmm. but they didn't flock to our church when we said we were going to start church and we want you to come. But they did. They didn't flock Mm-mm. to our church.
Well, and you know, when you plant a church, David always says you really need to know you're called to plant a church, because some days that's all you have is knowing that God has called you to plant a church to reach the people that aren't going to church. You know, it's what Gail said, different. Sometimes you have to step back and you have to say, well, why aren't those people going? But not in a judgmental way. You have to step back and say, why aren't they going? And why has God burdened us with the desire to help them know Him and communicate with believers, to unite with other believers in this thing called a church? And so it does cause you to step out of the box and start realizing, what can we do that doesn't change the message but is the method that may would reach other people? So what were some things y'all did? We did different things, but in Louisville, what did y'all do 30 years ago? Because it was, that's 30 years. Some of y'all weren't even born when. Some of y'all are thinking 30 years ago. That's old.
That's a long time ago. That's history. One of the things we did is to go around the neighborhoods around the church or the location where we wanted the church to be. We did have some property there where we were going to eventually build a church, and we did a survey and asked questions. So we would go to a home, knock on the door, and ask them to fill out this very short survey. And the survey had two questions. The first one was, do you attend church regularly? And if so, where? That was kind of the same question. And then, if not, what kind of church would you attend? Or what are you looking for in a church? So that really helped us to know how we could reach our community. But the main thing, you know, we did mailers, we did door hangers, we did ads in the newspaper. ads on the radio. But the most effective way, and this is true for you, for us as church mm-hmm. planters, for anybody, mm-hmm. is a personal invitation. Mm-hmm. The way people come to church, or really come to anything, mm-hmm. is when someone personally invites them. Mm-hmm. So it was a lot of relationship building. It was one-on-one. The masses, you know, they don't come. It's one-on-one, reaching out to people that you meet, people in the neighborhoods, people you work with, people your kids go to school with, and inviting them to come. Mm-hmm. And our main thing was just come and see. Mm-hmm. You know, come and see how we're different. Come and see what you think. Mm-hmm. Before you say no, before you totally turn off church, come and see.
Mm-hmm. You know, and that, what we want, another thing we kind of want to help everybody here is we don't want to be Gail and Linnell, two pastors' wives. We want all of us to realize we're all women who are children of God, you know, and we're all on a mission, and we're all wanting to reach the unchurched, you know, or we're wanting to reach the church that are hurting, but what Gail said is so perfect for any of us at work, at the grocery store, our neighbors, our friends, is just two simple questions. Hey, do you go to church anywhere? You know? And if they say no, then say, well, gosh, I mean, let me ask you, what kind of church would you go to if you did? They may, you know, they may say, well, I don't want to go to church. But just keep praying. God will open the door, maybe. But, you know, it's so non-confrontational. It's so not in their face. It's just a conversation to have with somebody. And so we just kind of wanted to encourage you through our conversation tonight, too, that the things we're sharing, we are wives of pastors. We are wives of church planners. But we're not different as far as the same mission. You know, we've all been called by God. So take those questions and bring somebody new to Flourish next month. So, Gail, let me ask you, and I'm not going to say the name, but somebody turned in a question for tonight, and it said something about how, I can't remember the exact wording. I'm trying not to look at the person that sent it because I don't want to give her away, but it was talking about the glamour of our life, and I had to ask her to kind of break that down because I thought, wow, glamour. I'm not quite sure where that is, but she did break it down, and she kind of explained it, but is there glamour? And I mean, you know, I'm being serious, because I do think there is a misperception or something, but is it easy or is it hard to plant a church?
It is not easy. It is very hard, and it's very lonely. Too. I mean, you are it. There's no group of people. I mean, mm-hmm. we did have a small group of people mm-hmm. who helped begin Springdale Church. But, I mean, you're it. And it whether your giftedness is working with children or whether it's setting up coffee or whether it's cleaning the bathrooms, it really doesn't matter what your gift is at that point. You just got to do it. And so it's you and a very small group of other people. Mm. And there's
hopefully.
No, yes. And there's no, well, that's their job. Well, no, you're the they. That's the person who the job has to be done by. So, yeah, it's hard. Mm. It's hard. It's discouraging. Mm. You know, you see people come for a few weeks and then they don't come back. And you wonder, you know, what do we do? Why? Are they not coming? Mm-hmm. So it can be very discouraging, very disheartening. Even, you know, friends may come that you meet and they say, well, no, I don't think not I want to do this. So it can be very hard, very discouraging, very lonely. Mm. And it's just hard work. But I think one thing you have to remember, and Linnell and I have talked about this, is you have to remember whose church it is. Mm. And God called us to plant the church. Mm-hmm. God called Linnell and David to plant the church. But it's God's church.
That's right.
And we do what he calls us to do. We follow him. Mm-hmm. We listen to him. We serve him in the very best way we can. But at the end of the day, it's his church. Mm-hmm. And that's really hard for a church planter to grasp because it's your baby. Mm-hmm. You know, you birthed it. You went through the labor pains. And, you know, you feel like it's yours. But if you hang on to that, and really that's the way it is with anything in life. If you hang on to that and you think, ooh, it's all up to me, mm-hmm. then if it's successful, you're going to feel prideful. Look right. what I did. Right. You know, I must really be good. And if it doesn't go, you're going to be discouraged and feel like a failure. And that's not what God wants either. Mm-mm. So you really have to do what God calls you to do. Be faithful. But at the end of the day, understand that it's his church to grow and to multiply and make happen.
Absolutely. And you're right. That's something that's a huge truth we can carry in our life is remembering this is God's life. It's not mine. You know, the minute we became his children, we were bought with a price. We're no longer our own. And it's a very, very comforting place to be if we will let ourselves be there. And if we will truly turn to him and seek him. We've been having a conversation a lot about God's will. And what is that? You know, and I was sharing with Gail some things, and she shared a really powerful, very simple thing, if we'll just remember this, about God's will. What?
And I was reading the other day, and it said, God's will, or your ministry, is just the next thing. We always think about God's will as being out here. So, okay, God's will is for me to do this, but that's going to be 30 years down the road or 10 years down the road. But God's will, our ministry, is just the next thing. And the next thing may be taking a meal to somebody whose house was destroyed in a tornado. It might be calling somebody. It might be doing the laundry. I mean, if you're a mom or a wife, the next thing for you might be doing the laundry and making sure your family has clean clothes. Or going to the grocery store and buying healthy food to prepare. So we glamorize God's will to something that's a nebulous thing out there, where really it's the next step. It's the next thing he has for us to do. And all those steps will carry us on a journey. Not a journey to his will, but just a journey of his will as we travel through life.
Absolutely. That's so encouraging, you know. And so I would hope that we all maybe quit trying to have the elusive big glamour wheel and just really, really rest in laundry. You know, I'm so sorry, but yeah, sometimes, like today, I have dodged unloading my dishwasher for 2 days. Now, what is wrong with that? I don't know why I do that. But today, I was getting ready in that dishwasher, and I was like, do the next thing. Before I leave this house, I have got to unload that dishwasher. And of course, how long does that take? Not long. But it's such a sense of fulfillment. But it was the next thing, you know? And seriously, that really, and sometimes it is a bigger something than that. You know, sometimes it's not. But we, you know, we've talked about planting the church, the nuts and the bolts. You know, our husbands were the ones that were doing the logistical things of pulling up to every building in town. I know every building here. If y'all need a building to rent, just come talk to me because I can tell you how many parking spaces they have. Was it good for this? Was it good for that? But our little granddaughter, Caroline, we pulled up to a shopping mall the other day and she said, oh, church. So I think she's a future church planner's wife or something. But so our husbands are the ones that are kind of always doing that, though, you know, checking out those kind of logistics. But let's kind of break it down to being a wife. You know, being that person that's not the one out front, that ultimately we're not responsible for the church plant. Our role is different. And our role is different.
It is different. And when we moved to Louisville to plant the church, it really wasn't all that different for me. And David and I would have conversations about that. His world was rocked because he came from a large, we came from Knoxville, Sevier Heights, a large church that had grown and grown and grown. He was the pastor. He was visionary. He was a leader. And then he went to nothing. Mm-hmm. And for him, it was very world rocking and world changing. Mm-hmm. But for me, I was a wife and the mother of three children. So for me, being a church planter's wife did not change all that much. Mm. I was still a wife. Mm. My main responsibility was to love and encourage and support my husband. Mm. And of course, that did mean some new things. And to be a mother to my three children. Mm. So I think we as, church planters' wives have to realize that that is our first and foremost responsibility. Mm. So that really didn't change that much for me. Yes, I had to do things at church that I had never done before. yes, I was responsible for things that I really didn't care to do, but I knew had to be done, and so I did them. Mm. I folded programs, I licked envelopes, I stuffed envelopes, I hung door hangers, all those things. But again, my role didn't change a lot.
Mm-hmm. But it's still hard because our role doesn't, but our identity maybe, or not really, because...
No, it does. I think that's true. Our identity changes.
I think, and our children... You know, because we're so protective of our children, and we're worried about them, and we're concerned for them. And y'all made a move. Y'all moved from one town to a whole nother town.
Right.
And so that was a huge change for your kids. And
yeah. And for me, too. And yeah. I don't want to make it seem like there were no changes, because it was very hard for me to move. We lived, again, in Knoxville. Precious church. It was our very first church. The people knew how to love their pastor and his family, and they absolutely loved us, loved our kids. They had older pastors in the past. We were a new family. Our youngest son was born there. Mm. I mean, they were so loving toward us, and it was a wonderful place. I was a pastor's wife, and I liked that role. Mm. So when we left Knoxville, on the day we left Knoxville and drove to Louisville, it was about a four-hour drive, we stopped for lunch. And when we stopped for lunch, I just couldn't take it anymore. And I just burst into tears. And our daughter was eight. And she's, oh, Mom, don't cry, don't cry. Think of something happy. And but I was just thinking, I want to go home. And I don't have a home. Mm-hmm. And I'd left our home there. I was going to an apartment because our house wasn't ready, and it was just kind of overwhelming. Mm-hmm. And so we decided to spend the night, even though it was just 4 hours to Louisville. We decided to spend the night, take a breather. David took the kids swimming at the hotel pool, and I just crashed. Mm-hmm. So it was very traumatic to leave that the safety and the security and the privilege of being in an established church that mm-hmm. loved us and go to nothing.
And the community you left.
Right, You know, I mean, we were somebody.
Yeah, and you had friends.
We were going to be nobody.
Yeah. And, you know, you mentioned earlier the level of loneliness. It's a different loneliness. I mean, y'all moved to Louisville where you had lived before, but it was a whole other part of Louisville.
Right.
So it was starting all over for you. And... you know, but what do you do? What can you do? I mean, I know we have a lot of military wives here, or a lot of military ladies who deal with this, or some of you have moved for other reasons, you know, and we've moved, but there's plenty of y'all that move for different reasons, and it's hard, isn't it? It's very hard, especially when you have children, and that level of loneliness is there, and you move to another place where you don't know anybody, and you don't know who's going to cut your hair, and you don't know what dentist to go to, and you don't know who can play with your kids. You know, isn't that hard? That's so hard, and you've experienced that because you moved with three kids. So, like, what were some things that you did that could encourage us? Because you know what? There may be somebody sitting here tonight that's about to move, and you don't know that. Because guess what? Gail and I, one day our husbands were on staff at a church, and the next day they weren't. You know? And so life happens. So what did you do to kind of help get through that loneliness and make it? Because I think you made it. You look great. So
thank you.
Yeah.
I did survive. Linnell
survived.
She survived. Too. So we will survive.
Yes. Always.
Yes. And one of the things I think is really important is to get out in the community and make new friends as quickly as possible, whether it's neighbors, whether it's friends of your kids, well, families of your friends, your kids' friends at school, whoever. But get out. Don't sit there because that's not going to bring you any closer to friends. So do that. Find something meaningful to do. Church planting will take up a lot of time, but it doesn't take up all your time. So it may be that there's a place where you could volunteer, where you could serve in the community that will get you out and get you beyond stuck at home, woe is me, this is terrible. Another thing I think is important is connect with your old friends. I mean, just because you move doesn't mean you have to say goodbye forever and never speak to them again. Friends were my lifeline. There were a few of them that called me all the time that I knew I could connect with, and that was very important. But, and again, I don't want to make this sound like a cliche or trite, but you have to depend on God during those times. He's been there. He's been lonely. He knows what it's like when all his friends ran away and he was left all alone. So he understands loneliness. And I think just to pour out your heart to him, he knows you, he created you, and he can see into your heart, and he knows how very lonely you are. But he really is the only one who can feel that loneliness. And he wants to do that. He says, I will never leave you or forsake you. It doesn't matter where you go, how far you move, I will always be there. And I love the passage that says in Joshua, be strong and courageous. Don't be terrified. Don't be discouraged. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. And I think it's so important to hold on to those truths. And I think one thing not to do is to make your husband everything and just drag him down. I mean, certainly you can share things with him, communicate with him. You need to know back and forth how each other is feeling. But don't depend on your husband to be your lifeline. Do these other things. And most of all, depend on a God who loves you and knows exactly what you're going through.
Right. Well, you mentioned having a heart for Boston, and you mentioned 30 years ago feeling like y'all would go to Boston and plant a church, and God said no, but he didn't say no just one time, right?
Right.
How many times did he?
He said no three times. We got very close. Some people can't get the message. We got very close three times, and every time God said, no, not now. During that time, that span of time from when we first began to think about planting a church there until actually where we are now, during that time, it wasn't like we sat around and moped and complained because we couldn't go to Boston. we did what we were called to do. I mean, we were pastored a church. We started a church. We planted another church and were there for 21 years. So all the time, though, we were supporting church planters in Boston. We were taking mission trips to Boston. We would go up there just on little vacations to be in Boston, and all the time praying and praying for the work there. And not so much that God would one day take us there, because we were content where we were. Mm. But Boston was always on our heart, and we always wanted to follow God's leading in ways that we could be working and serving and helping in Boston all those years.
Mm. You know, I think that's a great time for us to step back and go back to the glamour thing, because I think a lot of times people think that people in the ministry, that life is great and life is perfect. And guess what? Things happen in our lives that we didn't really expect, we didn't really anticipate, you know. I mean, you made a move you didn't necessarily really want to make. So there's a life lesson for all of us in that, because to me, one of the greatest things about David and Gail's story is for 30 years, they've had a heart and a passion for Boston. 30 years. And you know what? They trusted God, and they didn't get confused by it. They kept their eyes on God, and they said, well, God, we've got this passion. We thought it was to move there, but obviously not. But we still have the passion. What do we need to do? And so they were obedient, and they sought God out, and he sent them on mission trips, and they supported church planters. And for me, that is so encouraging, to not get tripped up on almost stomping my feet and, I want to go. But stepping back and saying, God, I still have this. You're saying no, but I still have this passion. So what do we need to do with that? And that's just such a beautiful example of obedience to me, and just trusting God. It doesn't always make sense to us, but he always knows what's going on. We get a very, very great opportunity tonight, because as I mentioned, Gail and David are the Sin City missionaries to Boston. Ta-da! 30 years later, guess where Gail lives? Where do you live, Gail?
In Boston.
yeah, that's right. We're going to be wrapping up in just a minute, but you started in Louisville, then went to Kentucky, then went to Knoxville, then came back to Louisville. But now, then you ended up where before you went to Boston?
Right. We ended up in Concord, New Hampshire.
Which is just an hour from Boston.
Right.
So y'all probably thought, well, this is close. This is Boston.
This is where we will be. Wonderful church there. We loved it. We loved New Hampshire. We would go to Boston almost every Monday. David's day off was on Monday, so we would go to Boston every Monday. But we loved our people there. It wasn't, again, we were present where we were, you know, and we were serving God where we were, but we liked to go into Boston. And then 2 years ago, the North American Mission Board contacted David and asked him if he would be the Sin City missionary for Boston, which includes serving all the church planters in the Boston area, encouraging them, strengthening them, helping them to build life-giving churches in the city of Boston. So all this time, God was preparing us. Mm. We weren't ready back then. Mm. But all this time, every experience we had, every church we pastored, it was building into us things we would need now. Mm. Where we are, and it's really fun to realize that we could not do what we're doing now. Mm. We could not have done that back then. But now God has prepared us. We feel equipped, not always adequate, but we do feel equipped to serve him in Boston.
So real quickly, how many church planters and families are y'all ministering to?
There are about 60 church planters
60.
Now.
Amen.
Our prayer is by 2025 to have 100 more life-giving churches in Boston.
100 more. That's 160 total. We could talk for another 2 hours on how awesome that is and how wonderful. We have a special treat tonight. We wanted to bring, because all those church planters have these precious, cute little wives and families, and they're adorable, the ones I've met. And so we wanted to bring 60 of them down here, but that didn't work out in our budget, in my budget anyway. And but Gail contacted about 8 of them and asked them if they would do a video for us. And so JT took all the videos that these ladies sent and made us a video. And we're going to watch this. And because we wanted y'all, I would love for you to meet all 60 of them, but that didn't work. But this is just a small way for you guys to see these women are on the field in Boston. They're there with their husbands. They left their homes. They left their comfort. They left their families, a lot of them. And some of them have been there 6 years. Some of them just landed in December. And so if y'all don't mind, we're going to watch this video real quick, and then we'll wrap up the rest of the night in just a minute.
Hi, my name is Gail Butler, and my husband David is the Sind City missionary to Boston. 2 years ago, David was offered the position through the North American Mission Board to be the Sind City missionary to Boston, working with church planting. One of my favorite things to do is to work with the church planters' wives.
Hi, my name is Becky Wyatt.
Hello, my name is Allie Rhodes.
Hi, my name is Mary Brown.
My name is Jody Hardis.
My name is Holly Mudd.
My name is Anita Samangi.
Hi, my name is Marcia Turley. And my husband Tanner and I moved up to Boston about 6 years ago to start Redemption Hill Church.
We were at Southeastern Seminary, and we began learning of the need here, the need for churches and just a Christian presence here.
Statistically speaking, Christianity in Boston is basically non-existent. For every 100 people that you meet, maybe 2 of them might consider themselves to be Christians.
We heard there are 85,000 Indian people living in Greater Boston area, and there is no evangelical church.
Many do not have a relationship with Jesus, nor have they heard the gospel before.
Part of the reason why we chose Boston is because we love the diversity here, the nations are here, there's so many people from so many different countries, so many different languages, and we love, love, love that we get to minister to these people and then they go back to their home countries and get to tell people about Jesus.
And Ivy and I have a heart to specifically show Jamaica Plain in Boston that God's love is amazing and authentic and beautiful, and we want to represent Him in the best way we can with our family there.
One of my personal passions is God's Word, and we all know the power of God's Word and how it changes people.
I will be the first to tell you that the road has not been easy. God has shown Himself to be so, so faithful.
And not until a month before we moved up here did I really feel like He changed my heart and helped me to really have a heart for the people up here. It's been a great experience and definitely made me trust God more and definitely grow in my faith.
It's just been really awesome, and it's been awesome for my son to see, who is 3, the power of prayer, and see God at work and what He is doing in the lives of people here.
I was just amazed to think of this opportunity that God has given me to sit around the table with these ladies who a year ago, 6 months ago, 2 years ago, were not even reading the Bible, had never picked it up before, and now they're reading it and they're learning from God's Word.
We have seen over 95 people come to faith since we started Charles River Church, and we are having the privilege of discipling those people and just watching them grow and thrive and plug into ministries.
Please pray for that with us, that God would break these chains and the guilt that these people have around religion. We are just for gospel transformation, just to see Medford and Boston change one heart, one person at a time.
Pray for me as I homeschool our 4 kids and try to help and encourage Ivy in starting this church and just being able to minister to the JP community, Jamaica Plain community, in the next coming year.
We appreciate your prayer. prayers and your support more than I could ever explain.
So just pray for South Coast Church in general, the people that are coming and the people that will come.
Pray for our church that it might witness to many, many people who are around us and in different areas.
You can pray for us and for Milestone as we continue to reach these people who've never heard the gospel.
Boston is a very dark city, and it is so important for us to share the light. The people who walk in darkness have seen a great light, and we want to bring that great light to them. And we so appreciate you for your interest in Boston, for your partnership, for your care and love for us. Thank you. It means so much to us.
Well, Gail knows every woman that was on that video, and I know a lot of them, and I'm really getting really teary because they're precious people. They are precious women. And we really, really, really wanted y'all to kind of know some backstory of what those women and the other, how many ever, 52, and Gail, and every church, but there's so many church planters in America, guys, so many. And, you know, we think, well, what in the world could we do for them? We don't live near Boston. We don't live, but, you know, so many of them mention prayer. Mm-hmm. And that's huge, isn't it? We went to a conference one time, and it was a foreign mission conference, but every missionary that they interviewed, they said, what's the number one thing? If you could ask for anything, and you think they're going to say money, they don't say money. They say prayer. Now, they need your money, but prayer. Gail, what can we do to come alongside you and David and those sweet women and help y'all with?
You know, excuse me, one of the reasons they say prayer is because the job that they have been given, the responsibility they have been given, can only be done through prayer. Mm. There is a darkness in Boston. There is a stronghold on people's lives that can only be changed by prayer and through our mighty God. And so, yes, prayer is vital because we can't do that because the job is too big. Mm. So as you pray, if you would pray for their marriages. Church planting is hard on a marriage. There's so many things that come against your marriage. They can be discouraging, the loneliness, the discouragement. So pray for the marriages, that they would be strong. Yeah. Also pray for their children, because these children are being exposed to so many things. Yes. Being a child of a church planter is so fun and can be exciting. Mm-hmm. But pray for them and pray for their parents that they would have wisdom to bring them up in a city, help them to love the city, but yet to know that it is a very dark place to live. Mm. And then another thing is just to pray against discouragement and loneliness. We've talked about that a lot, but just pray that churches would grow, that one by one, that's what it's going to be, one by one, people will come to know Christ, that the light will come on, and one at a time, a light will come on, and before long, the whole city is going to be full of light, and just continue to pray for individual relationships that they're building, people that they come in contact with, that one by one, their hearts will be open to his love and grace.
That's so good. And, you know, we talked about the unchurched. You know, that is why you plant a church. It's not to compete. It's not to just be different. It's because there are people that don't know the Lord. Or there are people that know the Lord that have chosen to remove themselves from the body. And we need each other. God created us to need each other. He created us to be community for each other. I've got a couple of other ways. We've got a mutual friend up there. Her name's Beth Tuning. She didn't get to do the video because crazy sickness and all kind of stuff has hit them. She has four kids. But anyway, she calls it Happy Mail, hashtag Happy Mail. But cards, you know, the good old-fashioned snail mail. Gail was sharing that when she and David first planted, they had prayer cards, and that people would get those prayer cards, and they would get cards in the mail from people all over America that they didn't know, but it just made your day, didn't it?
Oh, yeah.
To open that mailbox, and there was a personal note. There's somebody that said, I prayed for you today. I thought of you.
Right.
Today, you cross somebody's mind. When you're in a city and you don't know anybody, and you know you hadn't crossed anybody's mind in that city, how awesome, you know, to get that encouragement. So we have got a table right outside. Some of you may have saw it when you came in. Please, I beg of you, please do not leave here tonight without going by that table and getting the name of a lady, because we have all 60, right?
Maybe not all 60, close.
But a bunch. We have a bunch of ladies' names in Boston. And we please get a card. Some of them we have the addresses to. Kimberly Marshall is will you stand up real quick and let them see you? Kimberly is going to be at the table, so she'll have more details. I won't go into the details of how it all works, but I'm begging you, please go by and get a card. Write these ladies a note. Also, we have Robin Allred and Kayla Brinson are on that table, and they are both from CrossPointe, and they need your encouragement, so please do that. Another way is Gail does a retreat every year for these ladies, and you know me, and I'm all about a gift bag and little treats, and so Gail does that too. Fancy that. And so I really want to help Gail bless these women with the greatest gift bags you could ever imagine. So if that's your thing too, is gifts, then please come see me and we'll get together and we'll figure out how we can put at least something in that bag for them. But encouragement cannot be undervalued, you know? And I know every single one of you sitting here have had bad days. Every single person sitting here has had days where you have thought, there's not a soul that's probably thinking of me. And what it would have meant to know somebody thought of you. I've had those days. I sat in a Sam's parking lot one day in North Carolina, and I literally thought to myself, I could name you a person that was probably praying for me that day. And that this very, very lonely feeling, you know? So I'm begging you, please do that. Please see me if you want to help with the treat bags. And was there anything else? Well, there you go, girls. Planning a church 101. The backstory, the behind the scenes. But you know something, and I know Gail will say this too. I certainly hope we didn't come across as wishing we had not ever done this, because nothing is further from the truth. We wouldn't trade one second of what we've done ever.
Right.
Would y'all?
No.
To be in the will of God is the most beautiful place. It is not the easiest place. Don't get that confused. It is not the, but it is the most beautiful place. So if you want to talk to somebody a little bit more about God's will or anything, just come talk to us afterwards. But if you want to talk to Gail, she's going to be floating around. She doesn't mind if you grab her. She doesn't mind if you give her a hug, do you?
I do not.
But we love y'all. We just kind of wanted to give y'all a little bit of a backstory on this thing called church planting and why we do it. And we just encourage you to please remember, there are unchurched. And there are unchurched here in this city. As there's unchurched in Boston. There's unchurched in Quitman, Madison, Adel. They're there. You know, one of the things we didn't say was looking at people as individuals. That's really what it's all about. When Gail said the personal ask, you know, it's not just to ask, but it's to look at that person as an individual. I'm going to close us with prayer. Please don't forget February 21st. I think, did Maya mention it's a bonfire? So there's two new things to pray for: cold enough weather to have a bonfire, and no rain. But it will be a bonfire, and more info to come. Don't forget, if you want to get the Twex notifications. And we love y'all and can't wait to see y'all next month with your friend that you're bringing from your personal ask. So let me pray for us.
Now, before you pray, I do want to say, I didn't say it on the video, but I want to say it in person. Mm. Thank you, those of you who are part of CrossPointe, for the way you have taken Boston and loved us and supported us. It means so much to me, to David, to all the church planters. And just can't say thank you enough for what you are doing and going to do in the days ahead. So thank you.